Hi students, natural resources. In the last session, we discussed about two villages and their status and how percolation tanks help to recharge the groundwater. So where we stopped the last session, there onwards, now let us see. So the two villages, Vanapathi and Vadicherla. So after 5 years, if you observe the status changed, that is because of the groundwater level. Their income also varies. So how the income it will be, why it changes like that, let us see on slide. So in Vanapathi and Vadicherla, if you observe, so different ways we are able to see the income. So large farmer, small farmer. Vanapathi, large farmer, total income per acre in year 25,100 rupees. But if it is small farmer, got a lot, so that it is 29,535 rupees. If it is Vadicherla, when you compare with Vanapathi, it is very less. So in Vadicherla, 24,263 rupees were gained by the large farmer. If it is a small farmer, only 22,189 rupees. So here you are able to see different types of crops also. Paddy crop and cotton, gingerly. So if you observe, the Vanapathi small farmer got more income, that is because of the cotton. So cotton crop and gingerly. So if the farmer will grow only one kind of crop in several sessions, then they are unable to get more benefit. So that's why must and should change over the crop, especially towards to dry farming crops, because the water percentage is very low, groundwater levels are decreasing day by day. So that's why farmer need to move towards to the dry farming crops. So the crops which one need less amount of water for yield, such a kind of crops farmer need to select. Then only it is beneficial to the farmer and farmer able to get proper profit from their fields. So not only this one, to get more profit in the scarcity areas, the farmer need to change over towards to the micro irrigation. So micro irrigation means irrigation the farmer done with little amount of water. So naturally some crops need huge amount of water, some crops need less amount of water. But whatever the crop it may be, if the farmer use this micro irrigation technique, no doubt the farmer able to get more profit and the water consumption also decreases. So such a kind of micro irrigation techniques are helpful to the farmer and to the environment also. We are able to protect the water in this kind of micro irrigation technique. So what are those micro irrigation techniques? Here the first irrigation process is drip irrigation. So drip irrigation is one of the important irrigation technique. In this irrigation process, we are able to use less amount of water. See here on the picture, drop by drop water will come from the pipeline. So they will cover the entire crop field through the tube, means pipeline system, where the plant it is present nearby the trunk, means main root. They used to keep a small hole. Nearby the hole, nozzle it will be present. With the help of that nozzle, they will adjust the speed of the water. So drop by drop, continuously the water enters into the soil and the plant also able to utilize the water in a full-fledged manner. Here there is no wastage at all. Without wasting a drop of water, we are able to conduct agricultural practice through this micro irrigation technique. So in this micro irrigation only, another irrigation process helps a lot for us, that it is sprinkling irrigation. So in this sprinkler irrigation process also, we are able to get more benefit and this is also helps to save the water. So farmer must and should move towards to such a kind of micro irrigation techniques. Along with this micro irrigation, farmer need to recharge the groundwater also. They must and should be concentrate on the land and how he is able to recharge the groundwater. For that purpose only, must and should the percolation tanks. Along with percolation tanks, we need soak pits also. Soak pits means they used to dig a pit, and that pit they will fill with gravel, stones, sand and all different types of materials they will use to fill that one. So if the water where the low-lying areas are there, or the in any area we are able to construct these soak pits. So this soak pits will take more amount of water, they will absorb the water, they will retain the water, and they are helpful to increase the groundwater level. So such a kind of percolation tanks and soak pits also farmer must and should arrange nearby their areas. Along with this, farmer must and should follow several kinds of new agricultural practices. In that agricultural practices, he must and should use some micro irrigation techniques and some new processes which are helped to increase the production. Along with this, by dikes and barriers, he used to construct dikes and barriers where the water flow it will be present. These will stop the flow of water, and then the water it enters into the deeper layers of the soil and groundwater level increases. So these all are helps to the farmer to improvise the groundwater level. When the groundwater level increases, that it helps for irrigation and that it helps for proper agricultural production. Now let us see such a kind of water, how much percentage it is present in our earth. So the what are the percentage of water, how it is located on the earth. Now let us see on board. So water for all. So water is essential to each and every organism on the earth. So how much percentage it is present in our surroundings? Now let us see. The most of the water it is saline water, that means salty water, it's present seasoned in oceans. So seas and oceans consist this saline water, salty water, mostly it is 97%. So huge amount of water is saline water only, that means salty water only. But then how much percentage of fresh water it is present? The fresh water percentage is only in between 2.5 to 2.75 only. In this fresh water also, 1.75 to 2% of the water is present in a frozen condition. That means it solidifies like ice and in the way of snow. So 1.75 to 2% of the water is in the form of ice and snow. It is in frozen condition. Next, if you observe the fresh groundwater, what it is present in the deeper layers of the soil, that water percentage is 0.7 to 0.8%. It is present in the ground level. Then how much of the water that it is available on the surface of the earth, that is only 0.01%. This water only we are utilizing in the way of rivers, ponds, streams. So these all consist of fresh water, that it is only 0.01%. So we are utilizing this groundwater and surface water only for our irrigation purpose. How much it is available in the way of fresh water? 2.5 to 2.75. In that also 1.75 to 2% we can't utilize because it is in frozen condition. Only this much of water we are able to utilize. So that's why we need to protect, we need to conserve the water sources. Otherwise, the next generation can't get sufficient amount of water. So each and every human must and should use the water judiciously. Then only we are able to transform this natural resource to our future generations also. Otherwise, day by day the percentage will decrease, and finally this renewable water resource is going to be non-renewable. So This is the all over the water, fresh water condition, saline water condition, how much it is present in the groundwater and how much it is present in our rivers, streams and ponds. Now let us go towards to another important session. Here we are taking one more important segment, that is the case study of third village, Kottapalli. So here we need to study about one more village. What is the importance of this village and what we know from this village means, this village people are low in literacy level. This village people are low in literacy level. So when these people are low in literacy level, they are unable to utilize any technology. They don't know about the new technology and how to do the agriculture with the, in a better manner. Okay, so and along with this, labor also very scarce. Groundwater also very less in this area. Kottapalli, the scarcity of labor is there and groundwater levels are very low and these people don't have literacy. And along with this, these farmers are utilizing more and more amount of pesticides. So many chemical fertilizers they are using and so many pesticides they are using in their agricultural fields. And this is also one more drawback in this Kottapalli. So groundwater levels are low. There is no water recharge structures also. So which one helps to restore the water? Such a kind of water storage structures are not there. Any percolation tanks not there. Soak pits not there. Literacy not there. Labor not there. Instead of that, they are using so many pesticides and chemicals in their agricultural fields. There is no idea regarding to the conservation of soil and water. So in such a kind of situations, the Kottapalli village is there. So to motivate, to educate those farmers, here ICRISAT is playing a very important role. ICRISAT. What is meant by ICRISAT? ICRISAT means International Crop Research Institute for the Semi-Arid Tropics. International Crop Research Institute for the Semi-Arid Tropics. So ICRISAT educated the people and ICRISAT gave technical support to the farmers. And along with that, ICRISAT educate the people how to conserve the water and how to conserve the soil. So when the ICRISAT helped to the farmers, then farmers started a new kind of agricultural practice with the help of community-based and farmer-based interventions. So ICRISAT measures some kind of interventions are must and should for the growth and development of the village in agriculture. So for that, they insisted some community-based interventions and some farmer-based interventions. So ICRISAT conducts agricultural research for development in the dry lands of Asia and sub-Saharan Africa to empower the poor people to overcome poverty, hunger and degraded environment through better agriculture. So for getting better agricultural products, here ICRISAT helping to the villagers who are living in Kottapalli. So they suggested some community-based interventions and farmer-based interventions also. What are the community-based interventions? They used to construct some kind of machinery dams. This machinery dams helps to recharge the groundwater, to retain the water, and it helps to recharge the groundwater, helps to increase the water table in the earth. So in that point of view, here the villagers constructed 14 dams. 14 water storage structures they constructed with 300 to 2000 meter cube capacity water storage structures. So how many they constructed? 14 such a kind of machinery structures they constructed to store the water. to protect, to conserve the water. Along with that, 60 percolation pits also they made in the surroundings of Kottapalli village. Soak pits, percolation pits, they used to dig the pit and they will cover that one with layers of big stones, small stones, gravel, sand. So these will absorb a huge amount of water. It retains the water and it helps to increase the groundwater level. So such a kind of percolation pits also the Kottapalli village people are constructed in the surroundings of their village. Along with that, they used to recharge the water. In what way? In the village, 28 dry wells are there. Wells are dried, open wells these are. So the village people are started to construct dikes and barriers on the Nalla canal. So they have a canal, on that they used to construct dikes and barriers. So with this dikes and barriers, they used to stop the runoff water, and that runoff water able to enter into the deeper layers, and that it increases the groundwater and it helps to recharge the water in the wells. A complete user teams are formed for every storage structure. User teams are formed for every storage structure. What they will do in that? So how much water it is collected in that water storage structure, exclusively they are converted that water only for the purpose of recharge the groundwater, or the water they used to increase the water level in the wells only, because the villages are totally depend upon the well irrigation only. So that's why they want to bring back the wells with a sufficient amount of water. So that's why they constructed different kinds of dams, machinery dams. They constructed dikes and barriers, and they dug the soak pits, percolation tanks. All these are comes under community-based interventions. So when they used to construct all those, then only they are able to get a sufficient amount of water. So counterbunding is also helped for that, which involves the placement of lines of stones along the natural rise of the landscape and counterforming. These techniques help to capture and hold rainfall. So when they are formed that one in a stepwise manner, it will stop the flow of rainfall. When it is stayed some time, then automatically that water enters into the soil layers, that it helps to recharge the water. They also inhibit wind erosion by keeping the soil. If it is completely like a slope, for a small current of wind also, that soil is undergone into erosion. So the topmost layer of the soil will move along with the heavy wind currents. So that's why they used to construct in such a kind of forming that is called counterbunding, counterstrip trenching, that it helps to improve the production. So it is also helps to conserve the soil. It also helps to conserve the water also. Such a kind of one more project here we are able to see, that is called Sriram Sagar project. So Sriram Sagar project is an irrigation project across River Godavari. On Godavari River, we will see the Sriram Sagar irrigation project. So in Telangana, to serve irrigational needs in Karimnagar, Warangal, Adilabad, Nalgonda and Khammam districts. So for the agriculture purpose, to irrigate the lands, this Sriram Sagar project is highly helpful. It is not that much helpful to Andhra Pradesh, because the water, when it is moving and it is coming across to our Andhra Pradesh, because of this project, so much of the water is stopped here only. But it helps a lot to Telangana. It also provides drinking water to Warangal city. Not only for irrigation purpose, it is also helps to provide drinking water, especially in Warangal city. So now let us see the farmer-based interventions. Not only community-based interventions, farmer-based interventions also helps a lot to improve the production. So to improve the production, farmer need to follow this broad bed furrow system. broad bed furrow system. So how this broad bed furrow system helps it? It is useful to conserve the water. It is also helps to conserve the soil. It stops the soil erosion, and weeding operations are also we are able to done in easiest manner in this broad bed furrow system. Already you know, if the weeds are not present in the crop field, then obviously the crop plant able to grow in a healthy manner. When the weeds are present, obviously the production will decrease because the weeds will grow so fast than the crop plants. So this broad bed furrow system is laid within the field boundaries. The land levels taken and it is laid using either animal drawn or a tractor drawn ridges. So here you are able to see a broad ridges they used to take with the help of either animal or tractor. So when this furrow is broad, then it is able to capture the water in a proper manner, and we are able to conduct all agriculture practices also one by one in a clear cut manner. How it helps? It conserves soil moisture in dry land. So dry land means water scarcity. So you are providing water, but the land is dry land. So the water has lot of importance in this dry lands. Whatever you are pouring drop by drop, that it must and should be utilized by the agricultural field. So for that, here this broad bed furrow system helps. And also it controls soil erosion. It protects the topmost layer of the soil. Acts as a drainage channel during the heavy rainy days. If heavy rains are fell down, then through these ridges onwards, the excess water move outside in a sufficient manner. So in that point of view, this broad bed furrow system highly helpful to the agricultural lands. Along with that, we need to strengthen the bunds also. If the bund is weak, then the water, how much water you are irrigate, that it comes outside. You can't stop it. Along with water, what kind of nutrients you are provide to the soil, that also comes outside. So that's why we need to strengthen the bunds. How you are able to strengthen the bund? That is with the help of some kind of plants. What are those plants? Those we call it as Gliricidia. Gliricidia plants, plantation is must and should to protect, to strengthen our bunds. It protects the soil from erosion. So Gliricidia plants are usually planted on the farm bunds, on four sides where the boundaries are present, the bunds are present. On these bunds, usually the farmer used to grow this Gliricidia plants. Advantages. Why we need to plant this Gliricidia only? Why can't we move towards to other plants? It stops soil erosion and water runoff. This Gliricidia plant have the root system. That root system binds, captures the soil very tightly. So when it captures the soil very tightly, that it increases the strength of the bund. It gives extra support to the bund. So in that point of view, this Gliricidia plants are highly helpful to the farmer. And along with that, it is a legume. What is meant by legume, children? Legumes are a special type of plants. The root system of legume is having root nodules. Small bulge-like structures are present on the roots. Because of these nodules, give shelter to different types of bacteria. Rhizobium, you know very well, one kind of bacteria. It lives in the root nodules of the legume plants. That it helps for nitrogen fixation. Nitrogen is one of the important component for the growth and development of the plant. So when the nitrogen the plant will absorb, then only the plant able to grow in a full-fledged manner. All nutrients are present, but nitrogen not there, then plant won't die. It will conduct the process of photosynthesis also, but it can't grow. So for proper growth and development, the plant need nitrogen. So that nitrogen is provided by this Gliricidia. It not only gives support, it not only strengthen the bunds, along with that it also provides fixes nitrogen. That nitrogen helps to the crop plant, and crop plant will absorb the nitrogen what already fixed in the soil, then the crop plants will grow. So when the nitrogen is sufficient in the land, no need to provide any kind of chemical fertilizer again. So chemical fertilizers are always harmful to the crop. So that's why to avoid such a kind of chemical fertilizers, here we are able to grow this kind of Gliricidia plants. So plantation of Gliricidia on bunds increase the productivity of crop. Since it is a legume, it generates nitrogen and enriches the soil, and thereby increasing the productivity of other crops. So like this, Gliricidia helps a lot. So broad bed furrow system and Gliricidia plantation, both are helps, and these two are comes under individual farmer based intervention, farmer based interventions. So along with this farmer based interventions, community based interventions, farmer must and should follow micro irrigation technique also. In the micro irrigation technique, so they used either drip irrigation technique or the sprinkler irrigation technique. So 250 kgs of pigeon pea and 50 kgs of maize, a farmer able to get from 1 hectare of the land with the help of micro irrigation. So I think you can understand the importance of micro irrigation. 250 kgs of pigeon pea and 50 kgs of maize, from 1 hectare onwards, the farmer able to get through this micro irrigation technique. So the micro irrigation technique helps to save 70% of water. 70% of water, normally how much percentage, how much water you will irrigate to get a good production, in that 70% of water through micro irrigation we are able to save. But unfortunately, it is a very sad thing to say, 2% of the land only we are irrigating under micro irrigation technique. Naturally, it is very beneficial technique. It helps a lot for the production. It saves water also. But still, our farmers didn't understand the importance of micro irrigation. That much technology they are unable to reach because of the illiteracy also may be one of the reason for that. Only 2% of land the farmers are irrigating with the help of this micro irrigation. So here the water play very important role in the agriculture. So recharging of groundwater is very important, and utilization of water in a proper manner through agriculture practice also very important. So much of the water we are getting, in that huge amount of water we are using for agriculture purpose only. So much water we are using for our domestic purpose and for the industries and for electricity production, these all are very minute. So where we are using huge amount of water means that is no doubt in the agriculture. So it is essential for us to conserve the water in a proper manner. If we can't conserve, we can't give this water to our next generation. So that's why in the agriculture, how far we are able to do, it is either community based intervention or if it is a farmer based intervention, we need to follow in a proper manner, whatever the technique it may be, that it must and should be useful to enrich the groundwater level. When you are able to increase the groundwater level, then only we are able to irrigate our agricultural lands in a proper manner. So for that only, here we must and should use percolation tanks, soak pits. These two are very essential. Nowadays, government has also started the program to give the more and more soak pits in the surroundings. So this soak pit absorbs huge amount of water. So for this, no need of any specific area where we have empty areas. In our garden also, we are able to construct this one. in the surroundings of our house or the city outskirts, sides of the roads and all, we are able to keep, dig these pits. And we need to fill these pits again with the big stones, small stones, sand, gravel, and finally the soil. So when these all are present, these will absorb and retains more and more water. From the soak pits, you can't get the water, but it helps a lot to the groundwater. So ground is able to get a sufficient amount of water. Nowadays, the big problem is groundwater level only. It is decreasing day by day because of tube wells and bore wells. And to conserve the water, we need to follow the techniques of micro irrigation.